feels so quiet in here in comparison to an uprusting is on.
When you finish that scuba diving trip, man, it's a trip.
Are you scuba diving?
What? She's saying it's so quiet in here because like there's sound probably going in here all the time. So your new normal is like turn it off.
Here.
You're
blocking.
Yeah, you're definitely silence. I just thought it was a good New Yorker cartoon that kind of related to that, where they said like it was some old guy being like, "I know my tinnitus, and this isn't it."
So
I was like, I know my tinnitus too. It's very one ear and it goes in and out in a weird way.
So thank you all for coming. Welcome, I'm Cecilia Wickman. I am the coordinator of Stamp Gallery and the curator of this exhibition. And we want to really thank you all for coming out on this freezing cold day and hanging out. Antonio, Maxi, and Adam Hall Center are the artists who created this exhibition. And I think what we'll do this afternoon is talk pretty informally, just have a conversation. I have some questions that I want to ask you all, and I hope that you two will just ask each other questions as we go along as well. And then before too long, we'll open it up and give you all the chance to ask the artists any questions that you might have about the show, the content of their work, larger projects outside of the space, all of that. Anything you all want to add before we jump in?
No, I just want to thank you for the invitation to show. Space and flexibility. We're working on a schedule and not frameworks.
We should definitely, Cecilia is definitely to blame for this whole situation as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Adam. So I was thinking Black Mask, the exhibition, is really structured as a dialogue. We have two bodies of work by two different artists brought into the same space and sort of experiment to see what happens when you put them together. And so I thought I would start by asking each of you, if you wouldn't mind, to introduce the other's work. So Adam, if you could describe how you came to see Kenner Archive Project and how you see the work, and Antonio, if you could talk to us a little bit about uprusting. Mm-hmm.
Sure. Well, it's kind of interesting just to start too, so when Antonio and I decided to go into this together, we talked a lot. And I think we both really like to have robust theoretical underpinnings for the things that we do. But it's kind of interesting because we've both been so busy since the start that we haven't talked a lot since the it started. And now that we live in like a new reality, I'm very curious as to like what you're thinking, because certainly I think my you know the lens has changed somewhat dramatically. And so I think in terms of introducing your work, just from actually a very untechnical perspective, when I first saw Antonio's work, we met at an artist retreat that they had for Baltimore artists in August, and he was telling me about his work, and when I first witnessed it online, it felt aesthetically very similar to what I was working on. It was kind of like, and I'm a music guy, so I kind of was like, this is an album cover. Like, this is the sort of the album cover for the work that I'm dealing with, because he's manipulating things that are, you know, sort of as human as it gets, but it's also has that sort of uncanny valley aspect to it that I feel like I'm dealing with right now. So I guess that's I don't know if that's accurate.
Yeah, that's great. I immediately connected to your work when we met up at your studio. Dabbled with Maximus P a little bit back in the day in high school as we were into programming, electronic music, DJ, a bit of guitar. So I was very much attracted to that already, especially the interface of it all, having these rectangles with different sound effects and samples and lines going through with different effects. So I was already into it. It wasn't much guessing I had to do for, as far as like me understanding the relationship I have to your work. It was very much personal for me. And see all your drum sets around, your drum kit and guitars, so I was like, okay, this is great. But I guess I would just describe it in part by like this distortion of the human body, which is really emblematic through the audio, through the vocals and the marching and yelling and the chants and songs. And so I thought it was like a deconstructed audio component of what I tried to do. And I'm trying to, especially with this collage, you know, like Altar, yeah, for example, I'm trying to get more textual, more formal, think about atmosphere, think about black and whites coming in and out, different ways to abstract and distort the figure. And music plays a big part in the influence. I have my work, D'Angelo is a key figure in my work now, and I'm working on is a series of portraits. So I'm working with, you know, D'Angelo or Kendrick Lamar, or thinking about Fotech. So I'm thinking about artists who really explore sonically diversity, have echoes effects and vocals popping it out and going from a high pitched voice to a low pitched voice and having atmosphere and texture, ambient sounds in the audio, mm-hmm, too. So all of that I was totally into, and I'm trying to articulate that visually. And you're doing that audio.
Well, I think, yeah, but you reminded me of that, because when I came to your studio, I think, because I didn't even think about it in those terms of when you came to my studio, but it's, you know, I have a lot of different stuff from which to make sound, either in analog or digital fashion. And similarly, in a visual context, you have ways to manipulate visual images from a digital to an analog, mm-hmm, context. And I think that, tell me if I'm speaking out of turn here, but I feel like both you and I sort of see everything as like a political act.
Yeah.
I don't know. I kind of find everything is like, look, I only say that because it's funny how, at least like the subject matter that you're dealing, what I probably also related to so intensely was because you had such an intense breadth of processes available.
Yeah. Right.
The way that it felt like we just kind of, we read a lot, we listen, yeah, to a lot of stuff, and then it's just sort of like, oh, yeah, well, we have to manipulate in as many different ways as humanly possible,
yeah,
the media and the information that we have, but it's sort of under that guise of, oh, and also, of course, like every act's a political act.
Sure. Process is a key word, you just brought it up. I think that's a really big component to what we do,
yeah,
commonality.
Could we use that as a chance to actually back up a little bit and each,
sure,
talk a bit about the process that resulted in these particular bodies of work, and maybe tell us especially about the source material that each of you are working, mm-hmm, with? We could go historically, so Antonio, mm-hmm, you could start and tell us what the source material, mm-hmm, is, and then what is the relationship of the final work in each, mm-hmm, of your cases to the source material that you're working with, with the manipulation process, as you mentioned.
Yeah, I think the correlation, to kind of start backwards from your questions, we're just trying to think about forward progression. You know, how do you have a conversation of authority and history in which I have a personal stake in relation to it that I internalize through my experiences, being a young black guy. I'm not so much young anymore, but, you know. But also, how to have a conversation back and forth. I had a relationship with history and historical texts and documents as if it was kind of concrete and static. I was in school, and it wasn't much authorship regarding sides, compare and contrast, or what in the paper for. But I love theory, and it really becomes pertinent to me when I can practice it, you know, when I can like, enact some of these things. And so the way I enact some of these things is through the process of applying glue on these inkjet prints. These prints, these images are from photo exhibition done by Du Bois and Thomas Calloway in 1900, and which they surveyed middle class blacks in Georgia. So they had 360 studio portraits, which I'm working with. They had the other data in charts and graphs regarding income, migration patterns from the south to the north. So it was a very painstakingly detailed articulation of who these people were and how they lived and economic situations behind them, coming from slavery, sharecropping to the middle class. And starting to think about the middle class is pretty interesting to me, actually. Because this archive was like, this is a great achievement to reach the middle class and sustain this kind of economic realm, I should say, this category. And I grew up pretty middle class, but I never really thought about it as something special. You know, I kind of took it for granted. So then I saw like these people who ascended from there, I was like, oh, huh, that's interesting. And a part of this exhibition, too, was the Georgia Black Code, so laws pertaining to blacks from 1797 until 1850. So then you're looking at, so what is the social situation around these individuals that they had to overcome or deal with to ascend to the middle class, to make, however they had to make to reach that bracket. And that's an extraordinary achievement when you're like starting out with just being captured and enslaved from another country, had nothing. You know, like how do you fucking do that? And still have to go through Jim Crow and like all these other things, and still maintain a middle class status in which you're historically uneducated, under-resourced, redlining, gentrification, all these different things. So how do you ascend, right?
How do you decide what that ascension looks like, too? Because I think the portraits are such an interesting way to like to deal with that in terms of process. Because again, like you're talking about in terms of like historiography, you know, it's just a narrative by which like you know those in power decide to you know buttress whatever their present situation is. And so it seems like you know the source material that you're working with is very pointedly trying to use that very powerful medium in the context of the historical sort of document to say, well, here's how we want to present those that we feel have ascended. And again, it's the context is even more complicated because of you know what came previously, but how individuals in that specific group think of themselves or want to think of themselves as going forward. But we're also just sort of, I don't know, for lack of a better term, people. So, because I think that's like sort of what, you know, like what you're expressing is the same thing that I usually feel. And everybody usually feels, especially as they're like going through the growing up, thinking through process of like, you're just in your bubble and like everything's cool. And then for folks either figure out, like, you know, like I hear that a lot, like my grandfather used to tell me, like, I didn't know I was poor until I met rich people. You know, like, didn't even know. Chicken legs were great, and like that was just what occurred. And some folks, I think, if you have that bubble burst, and you're sort of like, oh, okay, like here's the hierarchy of things, and so would be it. And I think like we see things where like, holy shit, there's all these things. Like there are all of these things, and they have all these implications based upon all these, and they're all for extremely specific reasons, and a lot of them have to do with stories and power and capital and all these things. So like the source material that you chose has all of that, all of that contained in such like a beautiful way, but you then helping to, to explore what the other possibilities with that source material is helps to tease out, I think, you know, other, I don't know if there's like infinite dimensions that are expressing themselves all the time anyway. We usually see that one, and now you've helped to like parse out the multi-dimensionality to these objects.
Trying to crack open that representation that's so strictly defined by Du Bois and make it more abstract or inexplicable or find a new way. I have to think about these figures as shape-shifting.
Yeah.
Blending themselves or blending their backgrounds. So then they have some kind of agency in their own representation. So he was great into laying out the foundation is great detail, right. And I'm trying to kind of uproot that actually and make it more complicated. Yeah. Sorry. So now that we give you the great details of who these people are, let's kind of put it back. And it's like, all right. Now just to make it harder and more complicated and maybe get more diverse and kind of have a conversation about each person controlling the representation that isn't always explained or
absolutely
going through great detail. Like you can just be, as enigmatic as you want to be. You don't have to prove anything or, so since that work was already done, right. So what do you do next,
But that's what's interesting to me about it is that you have a group of individuals, people of color, in America from the time that they were, taken here against their will, sort of the least in control, group of individuals in a space and time, starting to, Du Bois is such a perfect figure of starting to reach that point of how do we, in a way that's recognized by history, so in this greater context, start to take control.
Right.
But there's almost the fallacy of control even when you're in control, right? Yeah. That I think that you're playing with, him very pointedly saying, like, well, here's how I want to take, I'm taking control, and I want to take control of my narrative, which I haven't had control of, my physical body that I haven't had control over. But you gotta go muck it up and say, like, well, guess what? Like, what is control even in that situation? You know, because that's a hard thing to parse.
I think what keeps it kind of not all over the place is you talk about the system, right? And the part of the system I'm working with is historical photographic portraiture. And I'm using the components within the photographs to rearrange itself. I'm not adding a whole lot outside of that into it. So I kind of want to work with the system and kind of crack that open. Mm-hmm. As opposed to making found objects or sculpture, you know, I kind of wanted to stay in the pocket, right? And just kind of just, like, invert that as opposed to adding all the elements to it. It's a lot easier to work with, so that's an interesting limitation and challenge too. It's kind of like the sticking with what's given.
But it's not as though you really had limitation. I mean, it's fine, right? Like, you're sticking with the process, but again, you ended up with very diverse output. Because again, I think that's one thing we've spoken a lot about is using, you know, because there's so many processes available, you can turn anything into anything. You don't even need to go outside of the medium to say, look, we can go the distance here in terms of aesthetic or theoretical.
What kind of effects did you apply to your audio?
Oh, sure. So,
because it bounces all over, for like different speakers.
And do share sort of what the audio is as well.
So the processes that I thought about immediately from the process side. So during the uprising in Baltimore, April, May 2015, I was out in the throngs of protesters, that's very, very much over the course of that, like 4 to 6 weeks, and then more over the rest of the year, even though that the protests started to die down. But in April and May, we really had those serendipitous occurrences of, you know, thousands and thousands of people marching all around Baltimore for many, many hours at a time. I had never participated in something like that, so that was a new experience for me. I was immediately struck, especially during some of the longer protests, after you start, marching for 6, 8, 10 hours, at the way that sound was operating in those spaces. I think that most folks, if you haven't been a part of something like that, at best you've seen that sort of 4-second media soundbite on the news where you have, like, you might have 1,000 people chanting in unison in front of City Hall or something. And a protest operates in a way that has, you know, all of the banalities that you'd have of, like, without a real plan, just walking around the city for hours and hours. And there are certain catalysts that come into play depending on how well the situation is organized. But you might have someone who starts chanting, and again, it was news to me that you're like, man, so if there's going to be call and response, somebody's got to do call. And your voice only has so much juice, and so experiencing people whose voices would give out, and how other people decided to pick that up. Or, you know, people walk at different speeds than other individuals, so if you have some people chanting in front of you and some people chanting behind you, you'd have these phasing effects start to go on. Or you'd have, you know, people chanting different things than you, or you'd have people chanting things in, you know, different areas around you, on the right or on the left, in front or in back. You'd have people moving at different speeds, so you'd have, like, Doppler effects happening. You'd have echoes happening. If you were in the right, you know, architectural setting, you would have things bouncing off of other buildings. It was, you know, to me, and again, all through the human voice and people walking. And I think that I've come somewhat full circle in the way that I operate with sound, or came very much from a primarily analog background when I was an adolescent, to dealing primarily in the digital medium for 6-7 years, and then coming full circle to always trying to incorporate mostly an acoustic electric process where we have acoustic and analog elements that are interacting with digital pieces. And so after I started to see some of this coalesce, I was really interested in figuring out how we bottle this magic. Because the other thing that I didn't hear anyone around me saying, every time one of these effects would happen, I'd like turn around and be like, did you just hear, like, that happened? That was incredible. And, you know, people would not react in that way, but I also was convinced that that happened, right? But I also thought that was the magic that was pushing everyone forward. you know, like that was encapsulating, because really the only thing binding us all together were, other than our physical beings, were the, you know, that manifestation in an aural sense. And because, especially in that kind of context, you know, sound is a full body medium. It always is. It's just vibration, so, you know, other than just the acoustic effects, like it's always touching people in a literal way. So I really thought that that was what was moving people forward. So I started to then somewhat casually take sound recordings of different experiences. I wasn't sure how this was going to manifest, so I was just casually taking sound recordings around the city while this was going on. But when I first started to develop the piece, I was actually convinced that I wasn't really going to have any sound recordings. I was just going to build a system that implemented all of these potential effects for people to you know, sort of harness the power of their own voice. So there'd be no sound recording accompaniment or aspect to the piece. The piece would only activate when someone activated it with their own voice, in just the same way that in a protest, unless you activate it with your own voice, essentially it's not occurring. But it became more clear to me, again, even in a protest, as long as you put yourself in that environment, things that you don't have control of are going to occur around you all the time. So the sound recordings became much more relevant. I had a limited source in terms of sound recordings that I myself personally recorded, but the now extremely prominent political activist DeRay McKesson, his Vine account was a treasure trove of samples, and he was very gracious enough to give me access to his Vine account to use all of the sound recordings that he had available. So I mined a lot of that, cleaned up a lot of the audio, and then created, at least for this piece, sort of like a 30-minute tapestry of these samples coming in and out. So that was like one aspect, building this 30-minute tapestry. And then I had to build the system, right? The system that, whether it was your own voice or the sound recordings, created that environment that was similar to, you know, walking around with 2,000 of your best friends around the city in a way that was emotionally potent, but had all of these aleatoric aspects that just occur, you know, in any, like, you know, the world's random. So I broke it down in those ways. Like there's a lot of panning going on here, sound coming from different directions, shifting. The sound was moving in interesting ways, and then the sound was repeating in very interesting ways, because you had a lot of folks saying things, so that to mine brought a lot of echo considerations. And those are like the two that I focused on in building the program, were panning and echo. Because echo, you can kind of get in some of the phasing and some of the Doppler and some of the other stuff. And the other aspect that I focused on was basically crafted 10 voices. So whatever occurred, it would break it into 10 pieces so that it felt like, okay, you could pan 10 voices differently around the system. You could give 10 different voices 10 different kinds of echo in terms of how it works. So those were the processes that I tried to utilize.
So I'm really compelled by this idea, Antonio, that you shared of human distortion, like distortion of the human body being something that's in both works. And I'm curious, Adam, if you like see a connection to portraiture in your work, or if you do now because of hearing it in this context, or portraiture or self-portraiture, is that there, or is that a tradition that just doesn't connect for you?
No, I think that, well, I don't mind grafting theory later, right? You know, like, I don't mind being like, it totally makes sense, right? I mean, absolutely. In the same way that I have, you know, an intense, very intense and an emotional connection to visual images, I have such a ridiculous ineptitude when it comes to trying to articulate visual images in any way, shape, or form that I can only operate on the, like, feels right when it's like, oh yeah, you know, Antonio's work makes sense in the context of of my work. But in the same, you know, I think in the same context, again, like some of the parallels of aspects of your work that, you know, run from like, from we were talking about Gilbert and George, or, you know, I think about like a lot of sometimes what we're doing kind of having this like Francis Bacon aspect to it, where you are like, you're manipulating these things, so you're not, you're never, we're never, like you said, we're never stepping ourselves out of the system. We're never taking ourselves out of, like, destroying the humanity that is, like, in... Because, again, I think both of us feel very responsible that the source material we use is not ours. Like, it's not, again, it's about other people trying to express themselves. And it would be, I feel, especially for my work, it would be vastly inappropriate for me to try and do anything that says, now I'm in control of it. And I think that's why, because the program I built is always random. Like, I'm never in control. And of course, there are gestural aspects to that, even in crafting the program, that my biases will, like, affect. So I acknowledge that. But I'm not trying to have, I'm only trying to offer different perspectives to the information and articulations of emotion that other folks put forward. And again, distortion is kind of an interesting term to put that, right? Because the implications of distortion too sometimes have these sort of negative connotations of like, well, if you distort something, it's not just a perspective shift, but also purposefully manipulating something to make, you know, someone see a perspective that you want them to see, as opposed to that which is sort of the honest or like the originally conceived of perspective for that. But I do think that portraiture is, while Antonio focuses on one individual and there's thousands of individual portraits that occur, I think especially in my work there are different moments, especially of that tapestry, where singular folks come to like the threshold. And I think it's, for those folks, it definitely operates in terms of some type of sonic portraiture.
I'm wondering, I think this connects possibly to this idea, Antonio, that you've talked about as being very important to you, which is intersubjective time,
mm-hmm.
a phrase that you draw from Lucy Lepard.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about what that idea brings to your work in terms of this mm-hmm. interpersonal connection, possibly with the viewer,
mm-hmm.
and time travel? And
It was really just a phrase to describe my relationship to the work being so distant from it. It just pinpointed really what I was going through as far as like understanding what these images were. So the idea of intersubjective time, which the poet talks about in Portal Recall. And in that essay, she's looking at a Native American family, a black and white portrait of a daughter and mother and the father. And she was really attracted to the portrait because it was shot beautifully, but they seem very happy, they were smiling in it. So she was, and this is, you know, done a hundred or so years before she existed. And she talked about this as a way to describe her relationship with the photograph and how it unfolded throughout those different layers of understanding. The first layer being just attracted to the photograph, this is gorgeous, and depicted something that captivated her. The second stage was understanding who the photographer was, so she did research behind the woman who was an affluent in Philadelphia. Her husband worked in like mining or coal or steel or something, so she had a lot of money. But she was quite independent in the sense that she and a couple of other women went out west on their own and just started taking pictures and traveling. And she came across first the daughter. So then the third phase is understanding who the family was, like who's the mother and the father and the kid, what was their context, what was their neighborhood life, the community, the tribe, you know, what happened to them. So that unfolded another layer of personal attachment, another layer of research, too. And all that gave her a well-rounded understanding of what was going on, but what she cared about the photograph, and the term really describes just that unveiling of understanding and attachment, personal attachment to a photograph over all these obstacles of not knowing the woman, having to do research with the photographer, and understanding the family, and understanding the context in which they lived. So it really is about just having a personal connection through something so distant from you. And it really comes from anthropology. That term is anthropological. biological terms. So what I was going through, the more I read about these figures, the more I learned about them, the more attached I got to them, the more I worked with them in a variety of ways, the more these figures started to stand out, like this trickster guy over here. He started to be repeated a lot. I started thinking about their abilities. So I became more attached and more imaginative about what they can do and where they were and how to pick them. So I read this articulation as having personal connection to something they had to unfold through time.
Well, that's my question, Matt, because it's clearly a term of art that I've been trying to wrap my head around a little bit as well. But it seems like it focuses specifically on the temporal aspect of this holistic approach to engaging with an art object, right? Because it's like the fourth dimensional footnotes that you put on your own experience of, as I continue to engage with this work, I have to continually reevaluate my perspective. And that generally anyone who engages with work over time can do that, but there does seem something very specific about the temporal, your own mm-hmm. personal temporal space that you continue to travel through as you engage with that.
Yeah, it's also a phrase that helped articulate what I was talking about earlier, to have an authority in history, to have a stake in it, to have some personal investigation and research, and have a development, not just reading one source, but looking at the multiples to get the holistic view you're talking about. So that word, that phrase really just kind of triggered all the things I was doing, gave me kind of an understanding and definition of all the things I was doing and feeling and the way I wanted to operate. I just wanted to dig deeper. You know, you just want to look at all these different aspects and understand the system we talked about.
Totally. Well, I have a question for you. So are anthropologists better historians than historians?
I don't know.
Because a historians are like, I'm writing this out, but you're like, if you have this practice, that's an anthropological practice, that's like, I'm going to think real hard about all aspects of the everything.
I would imagine historians have the same thing, right? You know, like, the more you dig, the more it starts to envelop and all these details come about. I would say I'm more of an historian than an anthropologist.
But it's just funny that there's a bifurcation between these like aspects when they're essentially engaging with similar material to create almost like similar work products to try and diagnose these things. I think that's the thing, because when we talk about it, you're like, why do we have these different things? Why do these different things operate differently? Like historians, the same way too, that I think it's in the same way that I think we even think of the work that we're engaging in right now as, and maybe it's why it sounded like the work was relevant to like many different departments at the university here. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure the way I kind of feel is like, oh, well, this makes sense for whomever to like, if you're like a newspaper reporter, or you're a historian, or you're an artist, or you're somebody else, to me, it's like the document should be relevant to all those folks' work. But I guess people don't really.
We're dealing with a certain level of specificity. Mm-hmm. And that allows for other topics to kind of come into the fold. So you're talking about process, or you're talking about a variety of injustices and police brutality, or photographs, or economics, or migration patterns. So a specific class, a group of people as well. So I think that specificity really helped bring a lot of people in to assess out there, understand what that point is and where to take it from there.
Right.
So let me ask you both, I'm going to throw two additional questions and then I'd love to open it up to the audience. So you all can decide how much time you want to give to either of these questions. But they're for both of you. So one of them is the title of the exhibition. That was a collective creation between the two of you, Black Mass. And I would love to hear you talk about the conversation that unfolded that resulted in that title. I think it links to what you were both saying a moment ago. And then also, you know, how for each of you individually this work fits into your larger creative practices, whether there are conversations that you're having in a sort of larger way with other artists or musicians or things that you're working on right now that have come out of this or haven't come out of this but are sort of top of mind for you right now, and, you know, let us know if there are things we should be looking out for from either of you moving forward. So title, Black Mass, and your larger artistic practices and what's next.
Mm-hmm. title came up in my studio.
Yeah.
It really was based on process and experimentation. You take it.
The math part is totally
something traditional and kind of.
Yeah. There's physics that work.
Experimentation to it. Yeah. Or reworking of that. Mm-hmm. What were you saying?
Yeah, I didn't mean to.
No, I
don't. Oh, no. For me, math is like that's kind of always the argument. I have that again. We're talking about how I think we take very holistic approaches to thinking. And again, what I was trying to say even earlier is like, again, if a historian is like a smart person, then they'll like add your work to their syllabus. You know what I mean? And
sure.
I can't say that.
So I'm glad you said that.
Okay, but so I think about it in the same way that you know you get into those arguments where people are like, well, I'm a science person or like I'm a music person. I'm like, you do understand that like art is just like if you're a visual artist, it's the way that light operates and light is physics and the way sound operates is physics and like all the you know. So if you're not a science person, then you're not a music person. So for me, I like the because. We both appreciate so intensely the pride. And again, like, you know, some of the work, and I think I was most inspired by, sure, I had to steal a lot of people's trigonometry to, like, get my panning right. But Antonio had to, you know, have chemical processes occur. Chemists are heavy mathematicians as well when, you know, he puts glue on the paper, right? Or he has these other, or in the same way, too, that even the digital work, like, that is a heavy amount of math, even if it's on the back end in terms of coding, that is occurring, and I think that that needs to be appreciated. You know, I think that there's, you know, like the word black has, I think, a lot of different implications that come to mind. I mean, you know, Baltimore is a majority city, persons of color. I think a lot of the work that Du Bois was looking at, black individuals who were coming into the middle class, but the way I think about it as well is we were thinking, and your work is in black and white, I think we were thinking about it in terms of these spectrums of from white to black, not just because of the racial implications, but also because of like, the aesthetic implications. And I think about it too, because so a lot of the other work that I think about, even with my piece, is I think that aesthetically, in terms of sound, my piece enters some of the realm of maximalist composers like Ioannis Xenakis, or folks that when, and I always think back to like when you look at a score of like Ioannis Xenakis or somebody else in that zone, you're gonna see like a black page. Like you're gonna see and usually it's a black on white or black markings on a white page. It's very very intense articulations, and usually some you can look at some musical work and not really get a sense of what it might sound like from its from the score. But I do think that a lot of maximalist composers, like folks, I can't remember who wrote Threnody for Victims of Hiroshima off the top of my head, but like there's a lot of these pieces that you look at the score and you have that visceral reaction like that sex is going to be crazy, like that's going to be it's going to be turned all the way up, like it's going to be turned up and so I was thinking about the way that was operating with two and you know black, like colors are so interesting, especially around different cultures, right? And some cultures means life and some cultures means death, like you know, so the spectrum of all of that, I think, had, you know, I think we both like those things that you're like, again, you can just like wax bullshit on for days of, I do. I know you do.
I wouldn't put it that
way. Might be the wrong term.
I try not to bullshit.
No, I do. And that might just be me protecting myself, again, you know, like throwing in some attempted self-deprecation because I just,
But there is a sense of plenitude, that the sort of maximal noise, maximal volume.
Maximal theory, maximal, it's maximal, it's a lot of stuff.
All right, so what's coming up? What are you looking for now?
I'm working on more collage work, similar to that, but now it's more transparent. I have an 8.5-foot portrait of D'Angelo as Mary Magdalene. And it's just acrylic medium. So it's that material without paper. So it's actually see-through. So I'm working on that. I'm working with 3D images as well.
Will that be backlit? That'll be on a light box, maybe?
I don't know yet. Idea now is a light box, but I have to execute that. Yeah. Well, that needs to be essential because it's transparent, so we deal with two sides. So,
and do you have any shows coming up that we can?
Yeah, I was just at Merlin Art Place under 500. It's happening today, Saratoga Street. George Washington University, Gallery 102. I'm in a group show there, a home built on memory, from memory. Platform, I think the show just came out. The flyer just came out for the show. I'm in a group show platform also on Saratoga, I believe. Or it is in the city, in Mount Vernon, and that's opening next weekend.
You got into that platform show?
Yeah.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
And also, the Maryland Art Place show he's referencing is all the artwork there is under $500, so go get this guy's work for cheap now. Problematically.
Very.
And what are you working on?
I think post-election I threw out everything I was thinking about, and then I've been trying to cull pieces back together of what makes sense to work on. I think what's actually come to light in the past 3 weeks is helping to facilitate a rendition of Pauline Oliveros' Sonic Meditations in Baltimore. And for folks who are unfamiliar, it's basically 12 meditation-based prompts. Pauline Oliveros was an experimental musician and composer who worked similarly in electronic as well as analog mediums. She did everything from tape and synthesizers and some computer stuff too. She had a really cool, I can't remember how it was tuned, but like a really interestingly tuned accordion that she'd do like crazy drone stuff with. And so I was thinking a lot about how to do things that I didn't care about me anymore, and her Sonic Meditations, it read like a lot of experimental music prompts that I've operated from, where, you know, sometimes you'll go to experimental music meetups or shows and there'll be a very specific like guideline of like, we're going to work on thinking in this way, and they read like that, but they also had at their base this really intense set of self-care principles. And it's really funny because I didn't really think about it until like this moment, that like connection between this piece. So it's going to be hopefully be all over Baltimore in the spring for hopefully a couple months in different spaces, open to the public, where everyone comes and they engage in these prompts. And the prompts have a lot of sort of sound and music making aspects to them, but mostly it will likely be, you know, voices and other things. There's also weird like telepathy prompts. So hopefully it'll be from everywhere, from like old buildings at like the old Hutzler building on Howard Street, I just got permission to use, and hopefully we'll be able to have in places like Druid Hill Park and some other places that really engage Baltimore. But it is funny where it's sort of like, all right, I'm just back to like people in the human voice in Baltimore City. And again, trying to give other people an opportunity to engage in expressing themselves. And so it's very funny how like, yeah, no, that's like very similar to where I was coming from. So that's what I think I'll be focusing, and you know, other stuff. There's gonna be a lot of, there's always too much stuff, but that should be, I'm gonna focus on that.
So thank you for sticking with us. I, at this point, would love to open it up. Does anybody have questions for Adam or Antonio or both of them? Yeah, here in the second row.
Antonio, I'd like to know just more about the usage of the 3D glasses and the 3D and what that represents.
Yeah, that came from this gentleman here. This is as if you're looking at a cross-eyed. So I was trying to think about how to enact that physically and bring up the act of being like paying attention that you're looking at something, right? So 3D came into the picture, and misalignment came into the picture in particular, having them kind of bounce back and forth between the left eye and right eye, and having them physically do what I'm trying to imply with this one over here. The glasses wasn't necessarily a tool, though they're not required. I still love looking at these without glasses too. But the fact that it can reverberate back and forth and like pop out.
That's what's so
about color too.
That's what's so
I just wanted to physically enact the and have people pay attention to feeling.
And you can
really have them reverberate. And the only way I can do that to images is to mess with, you know, our cones and our rods and our eyes. You know, really play with the color. Color interaction.
Optical vibration.
Yeah. So optical illusions are a very helpful tool to actually have some movement in the still image.
Yeah.
Antonio, well, first off, both the pieces are really good. Antonio.
Now you can ask your question. Go ahead.
I don't want to give props or props to you. No, obviously, there's a lot of work in both, and I've learned a lot today. I'm curious, just from having someone with a photo background myself with Antonio's work, are these constructed mostly digitally? And then I believe it said they're sea prints. So then you printed them? Can you tell me more about just the process of how you made these?
Yeah, I get these images from the Library of Congress website. They have the whole collection up there. And I print them out on the 2200, so I inkjet ink.
Okay.
They're not, these, and they're 8x10 or 11x14s. Then I put glue on them, and once the glue dries, I peel it off, and it creates these effects over here. Either I'm pouring it on or brushing it on, so forth. So these images, the ones that are faded, that have that glue process, are scanned in and enlarged. So scanned in from 8x10, 11x14, and enlarged. The glue process is really great because it's different every time it happens. So it gives me a spontaneous jumping off point that I have to respond to and figure out a way to kind of complete it or complete the figure or have them there. So everyone is different in its own right. So that's been a really great tool to kind of figure out as well. And did I present enlarge it? Some of the Photoshop stuff, it's a lot of copying and pasting, duplicating these figures, isolating them. Or isolating the background and like flipping it and burning it or duplicating it, overlapping it as well. And a lot of these moves came from the boys and Souls of Black. So think about the veil and double consciousness. It's like I had these images in my head when I first learned about that text. Back in college at Morgan State, first started school. And, seeing this photo exhibition really gave me a chance to exercise all those visuals I had in my head for a while. And a lot of the distortion we talk about the human body, it's my way to try to figure out how to articulate emotive images for the way I feel without being too specific or cliche about it, to how you articulate someone that's constantly shifting, changing, and moving as a person.
And to draw the viewer's body into some kind of response of a two-dimensional image.
Yeah. Because then it's about the cycle of who's taking a picture, who's been taking a picture of, who's taking a picture, who's viewing them, and all these different contexts, right? So what's the context of which this photo exhibition came about, and what was the motivation? It was a counter-archive, so counter to what? What was the depictions prior to them, or happening around these individuals that the boys feel the need to correct or alter, or be specific about? So having the viewer come in, it's been really fun to kind of think about that. I never really thought about that. So specifically until recently.
And that adhesive process that you're talking about when you mentioned the work D'Angelo,
mm-hmm.
you and with these sort of more built-up collage works as well,
uh-huh.
the you're leaving sort of the tactile, that part of the process
yeah.
is becoming the final work.
Yeah, so this other stages of the process that evolved from this part up to that or the small ones up there is that now that dry glue has ink from the inkjet prints on it. So now I'm moving that ink from the glue to acrylic medium, glossy or matte that painters use to varnish their canvases quite often. So then this leaves the ink with acrylic medium, which is really durable and transparent. So now I'm trying to be more abstract, more imaginative in the way I'm making these bodies and not be so stuck or strict to the source material. Because all these pieces are made up from these photographs anyway, so these figures are reconstructed into new bodies.
The resin process, yeah.
I think there was a question in the back,
yeah. Yeah, my question is for Adam. That's kind of like a two-parter, but it's about sort of the use of the quadraphonic sound.
Sure.
The first is like, to my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, but quadraphonic sound was like originally sort of like a weird fad that didn't go anywhere.
In the 70s, yeah.
Yeah.
No.
And like, so I was curious like what made you want to bring it back. And the second part is sort of on the recording process, like because microphones record in mono. And so you're trying to take something that's surrounding you and putting it into mono and then putting it back into surrounding you. I'm curious, like to me that's almost kind of funny. So I was just kind of wondering what you thought about that.
Totally, yeah. Well, so I think that I operated in quad because there are much more complicated and expensive ways to try and have like 360 dimensional sound operate around you. And due to my own personal and intellectual and financial limitations. Quad was it, you know? Like, it's the closest to 360 I was going to get. And it is really funny because even trying to find, like, you know, even using just standard, like, digital interfaces from today, everybody looks at you and they're like, well, you have six inputs, but they're all stereo. Like, yeah. you essentially have three stereo inputs, and you're like, I want four inputs to do whatever I want. And so it is interesting, like, where all the presets, like, we're a real bummer to try and get around. But luckily, Max, you can do whatever you want, so it's easy to do that. So that's kind of how I ended up in Quad. And I think that the mono's a funny question, right? I've done things previously, like there's definitely been like all digital, you know, all digital records that I've printed to vinyl specifically, because that's like a funny thing. I mean, again, when you're like, I've recorded all in digital, so now I'm gonna like transfer that to an analog medium. For most folks who do those things, obviously it's like a great marketing gimmick. But the way that I think, again, it was, I haven't even thought about mono. Like, that's really funny. And again, I'm a blunt force trauma guy, where I'm like, that's the only way I can capture the sound. It's completely, in many ways, it does not capture it. It's impossible to capture what I'm experiencing, right, in this 360. But that was like kind of the point of my whole piece. It's like, how do I, from completely, from the bastardization of, you know, trying to recreate, you know, like the human sensory experience, in any way technologically, you have to, you know, kind of pull from these, you have to pull from the different things, right? Because you could obviously, like, if I walked around, it would have been really interesting, right, if I walked around with the right way to try and record in more of like a 360 type of way. But I think that, again, primarily most of the stuff I do is lo-fi in terms of how I structure it. But if you want to try and like post hoc the theory on mono, right, there's a lot of fun stuff you could do in terms of, you know, sort of you're gathering together a tremendous amount of like singular perspectives. That are, you know, singular in the way that they're presented, and so when you shove all of them together, something occurs. But again, I think sort of as like Antonio was talking about now, this is what I wanted to mention is, again, moving from sort of these imperfect like encapsulations that you have, like the trying to have 3D. And then another piece that sort of like already does what the 3D should do for you, or like from a space starting there, when you shift that process, you're just getting, you technically should have the same thing, but because you put this additional process or this additional layer of technology there that doesn't mimic the human experience perfectly, you're going to necessarily get these new perspectives. Because I do think, I mean, that's one thing I definitely think a lot about is, a lot of the times, I guarantee, again, because of my deficiencies, that I'll never be able to recreate whatever it is in my head. Like, I'm not going to recreate this, you know, perfect acoustic experiment where someone's like, I'm walking down the street in Baltimore. You know, like, it really resonates because, again, I think that's uninteresting because the whole point is that there is so much of that in-between space that if you use what you have and then try to achieve something like that, you'll be able to get somewhere in a, you know, in a, yeah, that will necessarily be different but relevant.
But. Other questions? Sarah.
Yeah. So I think it's really cool how there's this conversation between the boys who, you know, is at the heart of the original civil rights movement and then contemporary civil rights dialogue. And so how do you think that, this is for both of you, I guess more Antonia, but how do you think that Du Bois would interact with this exhibit if you were here now?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if he'd be into it. I hope he's thinking it's thoughtful enough. Yeah, I would. I just imagine we'd have a conversation. I would ask him a lot of questions about what it took to put together. He had a variety of HBCUs help him got to research for this. He had a photographer to take these pictures. So I'm probably interested in the process. It's his experience. I mean, he arrived at the show in Paris so late because he didn't have funding for it. He won numerous gold medals for this exhibition. And the exhibition was never shown in its entirety either. And all these people were shown anonymously. So I have tons of questions for him. I'll probably dominate the conversation.
Other questions, Andrew?
Yeah, I just had one question sort of for both of you. So it seems like from what I gather, Antonio, what you're saying is that when these pictures were taken, they were in a way like a celebration or a documentation of like a positive achievement of the middle class for blacks in America. Maybe this is a bit obvious, but I didn't hear y'all talk about this. Was the decision to combine Adam's work with yours in part because of the protests were a bit about how a large portion of the black population in a major American city had no access to the middle class, and the results of that failure. Was that part of the discussion at all when you were putting together this piece?
Not so much, but it was there. It wasn't that specific, but it was definitely there. Motivations, why, recently. Someone asked me how my work pertained to Black Lives Matter back in February in the show I had in Mount Pierre, and I got a little frustrated because these issues have been going on for, you know, it's like, no, it's not influential, but it's about the same thing, you know, like this is not new, you know.
Well, I think that was like one thing that we talked a lot about is I think there was a part of us that was also like nervous that people are going to be like, this is just about, like this is only about like the very surface level like subject matter that pertains to like civil rights. And like so much of what we spoke about originally is, and that goes back to too, like every act's a political act. So you're sort of like nothing, of course, everything is about exactly what it is. So it is, right, I do think that there are those like unfortunate opportunities, but I think what really drove the exhibition coming together is all of the things having to do with theory and process, and how we think about the manipulation of documents and of works, and again, like we're just always dealing with the things that sort of inhabit our mind. And yeah, I think if anyone's paying attention, then like bad shit's happening to people, you know, like happening to good people and really smart people and interesting, I don't know. So yeah, it's possible.
It was kind of embedded. There may not have been the impetus. I don't know what the impetus was. I was invited by these two, particularly Adam. So we may not have a conversation about that, but that issue does run through our conversations personally. It's definitely there.
There was no intent. we didn't have a conversation before, and that was like civil rights.
It's embedded in the way we've been speaking about the work and the context and
the world.
Yeah. The world, yeah, and our jobs. And,
yeah.
Yeah,
totally.
Shall we take one final question?
Sure.
Yeah. Do you have a question, Joshua?
Sure. One of the things that seems to me that's a really interesting and important structural fundamental similarity in the work that each of you have done for the show is that you begin with something that could be described as a kind of documentary form of representation, and then you tweak it and distort it and change it. And I wonder if you could each speak a little bit about what you take to be the value or content, I'm not sure what word you would want to use, of that distortion. In other words, how you understand your work to be different from the documentary material that it begins with. What do you get out of the art that you don't get, in some sense, from its documentary beginnings?
Yeah. Personal involvement, for sure. Personal engagement. Having been in the studio and worked through trials and errors to figure out what's the strongest image or the way to represent them. How much I'm going to keep the original image and their appearance versus abstracting them. So a lot of it comes about the conversation of my relationship to these photographs and the context. And in the midst of working in the studio, too, thinking about, you know, how I grew up, you know, and how these people look and their attire, and what is my relationship to photographs, and I started thinking about, you know, biases and stereotypes of this chunks in. So those issues that were embedded in the foundation of this archive, because my whole thinking when I'm working on it, it's how does my relationship to this issues come about, and how do I deal with stereotypes and assumptions and pictures of me. So it really comes more internal, and it helps you kind of figure out how I feel about those assumptions of me and how I'm being depicted.
I feel like I've been manipulating source material for a long time, and I do it for many reasons. I think that, like, one of which is personal, that it's sort of like, even when I was in an educational context, like, I need to talk through things. And the only way I feel like I can talk through media is by engaging with that media, which is also why I'm not a big fan of copyright, is because it creates this situation in my mind that we have media in our face all the time. I don't even know if there's like music that's like playing through this building, or like, you know, like there's, you know, we have images and we have sounds just in our face 24/7 all the time. And so for me, the only way to understand those things is to take it and to manipulate and to engage. And then when you can't do those things, I always feel like that's someone saying like, well, if you want to have a conversation with me, you need to like write your own language. Like, you have to create your whole new thing. So for me, I really need that. And then the other thing, I think that I think it's very hard, again, people see things very statically, in the same way that when most people read a history book, as Antonio was saying, you just say, that's history. But the only reason that you say that's history is because you've never, there wasn't a footnote in your history book that's like, actually, this other person said this completely opposite thing happened. You know, and if you just had a history book that was like a point counterpoint, then you would be manipulating the text, and you would give someone the opportunity to know you can, like, your perspective is always up for grabs, and it's yours. So I do think that it's, I mean, again, in the same way that, like, when you're trying to, you know, have something like pass the Turing test, you give someone the opportunity to say, like, holy shit, like, human, you know, that, you know, they're, how, what the possibilities are here are up for grabs. So the minute that, you know, we just put something even in the most basic way a little bit askew from its original documentation, and again, people, it doesn't need to happen, but I think it's a good catalyst to have a viewer or a listener say to themselves, wow, that apparently the universe is slippier than I thought it was previously. And then that's the funny part too, is like that's a very practical thing, but then there's like the aesthetic quality where you're like, and also that slippy shit is just cool. Like, it just gives me the goosebumps, and it, you know, and it engages with these things that can be, you know, have these like pragmatic, practical effects, and it helps me better understand, and yeah, just like at a very visceral level, you know, when you get it, it makes you feel good inside. So, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of what ifs. This happens a lot in my studios. Like,
totally.
He did this one way. Du Bois was very detailed, specific. So what if you go to the opposite spectrum?
Yeah.
So what is the opposite spectrum?
Yeah.
And does that work? Or does that function? So what if this happens? Yeah. What if I get to the viewer and have him kind of move back and forth? So it helps to have some like options and curiosities and ask some like hypothesis out in studios. Or,
well,
especially.
Yeah.
So you kind of. Junot Diaz talked about the high order space, right? And like the part of your brain when you're so focused. And he talked about this in baseball. Like, he's so focused, he'll zero in on the goal, right? What you need to do. And they, like, batters can, when they're in this high order space, they can predict where the ball's gonna go and like knock it out. You can kind of predict, see all the steps ahead of you and like get a home run. Or if you're like bowling, for example, I used to bowl quite a bit. Once the ball left my